We've often complained on this show about Keir Starmer's habit of abstaining in Parliament. Now, we've complained about him doing this on the Spy Cops bill in particular. Now, it turns out we aren't alone in our concerns. Gary Neville, ex-England and Manchester United defender and now hotelier, spoke to Sky's Sophie Ridge about Labour abstaining in last week's vote on the system of COVID tiers.
Well, we're in tier three. We're being told currently that we will be told whether we're going into tier two on the 16th of December and that we can open hospitality on the 19th. How can that be? We can't order the food in time, you can't open your booking engines, how can people plan? You can't mobilise your staff. So we're in a situation whereby there is no plan, everything's so reactive and immediate, and it cannot be like that. Leadership cannot be like that. And I was critical of the Labour Party earlier on in the week because they're there to protect the disadvantaged and the vulnerable, and the restrictions being in place which protects health is fine, but they know that the economic support isn't in place aligned with those restrictions, which means you've got to take a position and be bold and go against it. You cannot abstain. And that's where people of Manchester at this moment in time, I think, are frustrated with the lack of leadership in, I suppose, protecting the residents of Manchester and the communities that are hardest hit.
So you'd have liked to see Labour vote against the tier system then?
Yeah, I don't like half rows leadership. Take a stance. You've got, you go out in your general election, you're told in your general election to all the people on the doorsteps, get out and vote. So when you're elected and you're in that seat in Westminster, you just take a position. You don't abstain. You take part in the match. You're the opposition. You're the opposition. Don't sit in the stand. They sat in the stand.
The sentiment that Gary Neville is expressing there, I agree with, and I think that the Labour Party has abstained way too many times on really significant issues. I actually do think that on this particular instance, even if it's been very poorly communicated by the leadership, there was some logic, because basically what Gary Neville there is suggesting Labour should have done is vote against to hold out for more financial support for businesses during the restrictions in the various tiers, and in a similar way to how Andy Burnham held out as mayor of Manchester, saying I'm not going to approve these measures until you offer more financial support for the residents of my city. The argument against Labour doing that in this particular situation was that if they had voted against, then Boris Johnson, to get it passed, wouldn't be negotiating with Labour. He'd be negotiating with his own rebellious backbenchers. And the rebellious backbenchers are the type of right-winger who just want, general restrictions to be looser, the kind of anti-lockdown crowd. So there was a risk that if Labour committed to voting against the proposal, Boris Johnson's sort of policy would get shifted to the right, not be shifted to more financial support, but to be, a dangerously low level of restrictions. Ash, what do you make of this? Gary Neville, I think in the general point is correct. I mean, we've seen Keir Starmer sort of being completely addicted to abstention. And I do think the overall impression it gives is someone who is unwilling to commit to anything.
This individual act of abstention I didn't actually have a problem with, because you've got a twofold problem. One is that it sends Boris Johnson negotiating with his headbangers, who think that the best cure for coronavirus is poor people getting it. And on the other hand, you've got a communication issue with the public. Well, you say that you want lockdown, so why are you voting against it? You've been castigating the government for being late for going in. There's a kind of muddiness of message there. But I think the overall diagnosis, which is that Keir Starmer is someone who seems to lack a core motivating story in a way that Jeremy Corbyn certainly didn't lack a core motivating story, in a way that Tony Blair certainly didn't lack a core motivating story. There's still this issue of Keir Starmer being so reactive, defining himself, I think, most clearly when it comes to internal party management and, taking a hammer to his own, rowdy left-wing backbenchers, that when it comes to speaking to the nation on some of these issues, and I'm not just talking about the issues which animate the left in particular, like spy cops or overseas operations, but on reopening schools, having this kind of half in, half out, yes, we want them open, no ifs, no buts, but also, is this going to be safe enough? Very much only condemning or supporting things in full throat when it's in the rearview mirror, is that you're going to get to 2023, and we're a year out from a general election, and people are still going to be asking, who is this guy? Who does he stand for? What does he stand for? So when the policies start coming out, it's going to lack, I think, an anchor. And that's what a leader has got to be. He's got to be totemic of certain values, and he's got to be an anchor for those policies.
I mean, it's important to say as well, the difference between this one and the Spy Cops one is the justification for abstaining on this was that otherwise the policy could have got taken to the right by the headbangers on Boris Johnson's backbenches. That would not have happened with Spy Cops. That dynamic was not there. So the only reason Keir Starmer abstained then was because he wanted to keep his hands clean. He wanted to say, well, I'm not necessarily against it. I'm not really for it. It was literally the definition of sitting on the fence. There was no other explanation for that. And I think the fact he has abstained so many times in the past is precisely why, even when it might make sense to do so, it just makes him look like a shifty fence sitter, because that's the impression we've already been given. And, you know, we're not going to be able to get to 2024 in the manifesto. Just say we don't really have any policies, but we think everything should be done with clarity and with a strategy, which is basically their critique of everything this Conservative government does. Ash, your final thoughts on this one?
Okay, so you raise actually a really interesting point about what happens when a manifesto comes out, because here's a lesson that I've learned from 2019. This is something which I was definitely wrong about. I loved manifestos which were just chock full of policies, all right? UBI, give me a bit of that. Rent controls, I'll have that too. Four-day working week, delicious. And what Boris Johnson did was the manifesto was real back of a fag packet stuff. I mean, there was hardly anything in it. But he painted things in primary colours, broad brush, and he, as a central figure who was promising to do one simple thing, get Brexit done, end all of this nasty politics, was able to, you know, sell nothingness and do it really, really well. So I think we are actually also entering an age where manifestos are less important than the personality animating a set of politics, something that Jeremy Corbyn did very, very well in 2017. Of course, after, you know, 4 years of being completely traduced in the press, he couldn't do that in the same way in 2019. And that's going to be something which Keir Starmer, if he just abstains, on everything that he looks at, he's going to lack that moral authority.